With all of our Mastinax animations, we recommend that you watch them twice, back to back. First, just for fun, and a second time with guided questions and discussion. However, Scale Ella at 10 minutes, watched twice, limits the time for that discussion, which is very important. So we recommend that you watch it at the end of a class period, let the students think about it, and then come back the next morning, ask them some questions to find out where they're at conceptually, and then watch it the second time. Give me an example of something that you have seen that is like either shrunk down or made really, really big.
Lego people. Animal and the Lego and the Muppet movie.
Children compared to adults.
A meteor coming towards the earth.
Hedemias, what was Scaleo doing?
He was making things bigger and smaller.
He was making things bigger and smaller, right? And let's see, Tim, what was Scalella doing?
Making it better or making it worse.
Why would you say she was making it worse? I like to ask the students which vocabulary words they remember from the first viewing, and then during the second viewing, I ask them to track all of the math vocabulary so that we can use it later in the lesson. So since we're in math class, we need to talk a little bit about some of the math words or the math vocabulary that you heard in the video. So does anybody have a math word that they heard in there? Renee?
Scale factor.
Scale factor, okay. So that one's probably gonna be something that's pretty important, I would say, right? What else? What were some other math words that we heard? Right here.
Depth.
Depth. Okay, what went along with the depth?
The width and height.
Depth, width, and height. So what we're gonna do now, because there's lots more, but what we're gonna do now is we're gonna watch the video again. I'm gonna stop it a little bit, and what I want you to pay attention to is some of the math words or the math concepts that are being shown. Because after we're done, then you guys are gonna have to do some scaling yourself. Does that make sense? All right, so pay real close attention to some of the math vocabulary. We might stop it a couple times.
2 times what is 10? 5. 5 is the scale factor.
Okay, so I wanna talk a little bit about this. 5 is the scale factor. What did she do to find that out? What did she do to figure that out? Right here, Naomi.
She divided?
What did she divide?
She divided 10 divided by 2.
10 divided by 2? What's another way that she could have found that? Let's see, Dawson.
2 times what is 10?
Scale Ella provides examples of scaling up and scaling down, but really what it does is it shows students that there's a variety of ways to solve a problem.
21 times what is 7?
All right, so I'm gonna pause it right here before they go any further. Okay, so Sydney, 21 times what gives you 7?
-3.
21 times -3, let's stop and think about that. Is that gonna work? So I'm gonna get -63, but you're on the right track because you knew it wasn't 3, so let's stop and think. It's not gonna be -3, so what other thing do you think it might be? Right here in the front.
0.33.
0.33, okay, so let's try that. If I do 21 times, where'd you get 0.33? Does anybody know what the fraction form of 33 hundredths is?
1/3.
1/3, so I could do 21 times 1/3. So we have a couple of different guesses here. Let's see what she ended up doing. So 1/3 is the scale factor. What was different between the first scale factor and the second scale factor?
In the first one, they scaled up.
In the first one, they scaled up.
And the second one, they scaled down.
Second one, they scaled down. What is this an example of? If I have the picture on the computer screen and I have the picture up there.
You scaled it up.
I scaled it up. Could we figure out what the scale factor was?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
How?
By measuring,
right? We could measure it and figure out what the scale factor is. When scaling down, students may have a lot of misconceptions. For example, they might try to use negative numbers or think of the scale factor in terms of addition and subtraction instead of multiplication and division. The learner guide is a great way to clear up these misconceptions. The first scale factor you're going to pick is something you're going to scale up. So what has to be true about that number, that scale factor that you pick? It has to be
bigger than one.
For this section right here, if it's scaled down, what does that number have to be? Less than one. All right. What, when I'm scaling down, what are two different ways that I can represent a number that is less than one? Kendall.
Decimals or fractions?
Decimals or fractions. Lindsay, how tall are you?
5 feet 2 inches.
5 feet 2 inches. So if I said, okay, I want you to scale that up by 7, how would you do that? So are there multiple ways to do this? Yeah, you deal with whatever is most comfortable for you, okay? Students can have trouble visualizing the effects of a scale factor. So in order to prepare for our hands-on activity, I drew a small image on the board and we used a ruler to increase that image using a scale factor of 3. And the reason I wanted Sydney to do that is because I think our concept of scaling things up is very skewed. So a lot of us think, oh, well, if I increase my TV by 100, you think, oh, that's not going to be that much. Like, we're thinking in addition, but when we think about multiplication, it actually makes things really, really, really a lot bigger than the original. For our main activity, I gave each group of students a piece of a puzzle, but before they put it back together, they had to scale it up. They decided on a scale factor of 5. I asked them to work on the outer rectangle first, then on the image inside. So you might want to look at your puzzle piece and look at the key differences or things or places where it changes. So for example, in this one, there's this little brown line. I might want to measure that and then use my scale factor to increase it by 5. This little yellow part right here, measure it, increase it again by 5. You can do the same thing for the height. So look at your key pieces and then you can estimate where you're going to put everything else. Does that make sense? Okay, go ahead. Get started on your puzzle pieces. Students may use different methods of measuring, so point it out. Give them tools like graph paper, rulers, straight edges, just to help them in the process. And then we'll just take it like this. Mm-hmm. So that this. How many of you measured using your ruler? How many of you used the graph paper, the little grid on the graph paper? Is it okay that you guys did it different ways? Or if you use centimeters versus inches when you were scaling up, did it matter which dimension you used? No. Because you were using it for your little puzzle piece, right? Look at that. Puzzle. Are all of yours kind of coming along like this? So we're going to finish up, and in a while, we're going to go ahead and put it up here so that we have the small puzzle. Are you guys able to put together the big puzzle? Yeah, and see what it looks like. So before we get these finished, I want to have our closing discussion. So what was it that you learned today? Kendall.
Stuff about scale factor.
Stuff about scale factor. What is the most important thing you have to remember about scale factor? When you are talking about scale factor, what operations are you focused on? Let's say I have the number 20 and my scale factor is 1/2. Give me one way that I could decrease it. Renee, give me a second way that I could do this.
You could multiply by 1/2.
I could multiply 20 by 1/2. So I could multiply 20 by 1/2. There's a third way that I could do this scale factor of 1/2. Does anybody want to tell me what it is that I could do? So when you're scaling down and you have a scale factor less than 1, you can represent it as a fraction or a decimal. You can use division. This would be the only time in scale factor where you're going to use division. You can divide by 2. I can multiply by 1/2, or I can convert it to a decimal and multiply by my decimal. Look at your little teeny tiny puzzle compared to your big puzzle piece when you scaled it up by 5. It made a big difference, right?
Yes.
And we have to make sure that we keep in mind the depth, width, and height. If it's 3-dimensional, if it's 2-dimensional, we're talking about width and height. Anything else? You think we kind of closed it up pretty good? All right. So let's get our puzzle pieces done and let's see what it's going to look like at the end. We are not looking for perfection here. This is simply a visual way for the students to see the importance of scale factor, accurate measurements, and correct calculations. I really love all of the hands-on activities provided in the support materials for each MathSnack animation. They provide students the opportunity to become actively involved in creating, in drawing, in measuring, and in doing mathematics. This gives them a visual way to see how math is relevant in their everyday lives.
This is a job for scale.
Oh, how I despise text messaging.
Don't panic, ladies. I can solve your problem using scale factor. My scaling power is out of sight. How's that, honey?
My giant thumbs fit perfectly on the keys again.